So here's the thing. It usually makes partial sense until we look at it in a very practical way. So let me show you what it looks like in real life. So I'm going to describe an event that happened. This is a real event. I know it's real because it was me when I was about 18 years old. It's nothing real severe, but what happened was when I was 18, I was working for this small contractor. We do work in industrial environments, and we would do demo work, pour concrete, hang steel, all kinds of stuff. And I was just a general laborer. And so one day I showed up work at the site. My foreman said, "Hey, Lynn, I want you to go move this grating that we had tore out of a platform, and I want you to haul it out back." So it was three or four sheets of 4x4 heavy industrial grating that had been a part of a platform. So that was all he told me, move it out back to the scrap bin. And so I look at it, and I think, okay, first thought was, well, I can drag it through the plant. You know, I'm 19, what can you not do when you're 19? And so I thought, well, that's one way, but that's too hard. So I found some hand trucks, just a simple set of hand trucks, a dolly, and said, I can load it up and take it out back. And so I pack on all three sheets. I got everything I possibly could on that dolly. Okay, so because my mind was thinking like your mind thinks when you take the groceries out of your car to your kitchen. What do you do? Do you take as many trips as possible? Or do you load it up? David, you crack those eggs and everything loading your arms up, don't you? That's right. You want to take one trip, even though it's a short walk. My mindset was the same. I want to take one trip hauling this grating. And so I thought, I'm 19, I can do anything. And so I take it and I'm bouncing through the plant, and I didn't strap it down. There was no way to strap it down. There was nothing to secure it. And so I hit some uneven grating. And so it started wobbling. And so when it was sliding around, I didn't want to dump it in the floor in front of everybody. So what did I do? I reached to stabilize it. And so in the process, I got my hand caught in between two sheets of the grating. And so it just ripped the top of my hand open. And so it was it doesn't hurt because the top of your hand doesn't have as much feeling. But I could see the veins and the tendons in my hand. And my first reaction was, who saw? I mean, it's kind of like if you slip and fall, your first reaction is, all right, who saw me? And so I got jumped up. I didn't want anybody to notice. And so I loaded it back up and hauled the grating to the back. Found a rag, wrapped it up with some duct tape, and went about my work because I just wanted to finish the day. I wanted to get paid. I didn't want to go home. And so I was bleeding, and my foreman says, hey, you need to go see the nurse. This is after, I can't use this colorful language in this setting, but he let me have it, you know, for doing something stupid. And I'm like, I'm that young summer helper laborer just nodding my head trying to get through the day. So the nurse told me I need to get it sewed up. And so I thought, well, my mom would do it. She's a nurse when I went home. And that's what happened. You know, I went to her doctor's office. They sewed it up. And I thought, big deal. When you're 19, things don't register as a big issue. I get back to work the next day, and the owner of that company called me in his office and just laid into me. I mean, he let me have it because I did something what? Stupid. I mean, in his mind, he's thinking, what were you thinking? Why didn't you take two trips? I mean, he just blistered me. And in my mind, thinking, yep, you're right, you're right, you're right. So there was an ownership side of it from my perspective. But here's the thing. If you break down the steps and begin to build the context, things change a little bit. You've got an old school way to look at it. You've got a new way to look at it. I got to work about 7 a.m. in July 8th. The foreman instructed the crew to move the scrap grating from inside the plant to a staging area behind the plant. That was about 7:15. I located some hand trucks to move the grating around 7:30. I loaded three sheets onto the hand trucks and transported it across the inside of the plant. That was around 7:35. Lost control of the hand trucks, and they struck some uneven portion of the floor. Around 7:45, I reached to stabilize the grating. That's when I got my hand caught and ended up with 5 stitches. So in a lot of settings, especially traditional thinking, that's all you need, right? You know exactly what happened. I hauled some stuff across the plant and got hurt. Made some bad choices and got hurt. But in reality, that's old school. That's a traditional way to look at it. Now, you can chew me out, which I deserve some of it, but the reality is that correcting anything other than me? No. So if you look at the context of the event, you learn something different. That old school side is more of a blame culture, meaning that the owner of the company chewed me out, the foreman chewed me out, so in their minds, they fixed the problem. David was the problem, which I was part of the problem. Don't get me wrong. I'm not trying to push off my own responsibility, But if you want to make a difference in a new HP kind of way, you've got to look at this last question at the bottom. You've got to understand how and why it made sense for me to do what I did, and what was I trying to accomplish? Why didn't I think about it in a different way? That's kind of that new, broader way to look at it. So if you do that and put it in context, what you end up with is that, first of all, got there at 7 o'clock. I was temporary summer help, and I started work about 4 weeks before that incident, so I was pretty new, green behind the ears. There was no safety orientation or safety training at all. You could see that I was fit for duty, and I had no prior experience. So now you see a little bit of context around the event. It tells you a little bit about me as a worker. A lot of inexperience, not a lot of training and coaching. When you move down the list, when we got the instructions, we had three-man crew do a miscellaneous type cleanup, but we had PPE, we had hard hats, we had safety glasses, earplugs, and no gloves. Okay, so that's good to know, right? So there was no pre-job brief and there were minimal instructions. So doesn't that kind of give you a taste of the context? If you move on down the list, contractor owned the hand trucks. They were industrial grade, we'll say. There was a forklift available, but I didn't know how to drive it, and so I didn't use it. I didn't look for a pallet jack or any other means to use it. Everything was in good condition, so it was just a decision. Hand trucks, best option, move forward. You lose down the list, I loaded the grading to take one trip and save time. So if you go back to error precursors, what is one of those precursors? You want to be able to save time. So that was a predictor. I overloaded the grading. I don't know how much it weighed. It was unstable. And supervisor didn't monitor or correct me. And so I walked over. The walking surfaces was uneven. Foreman didn't tell me how to go or where to go. And the grading bounced during travel. And so my natural reaction was to stick my hand in there in the line of fire, and that's where I got my hand caught. There was no gloves and no glove policy. So here's what I want you to think about. Old school, the green, dark green is enough. Traditional way of thinking, you've got enough to move forward. You document it, you put the blame where the blame belongs with the employee, and then you feel good about your investigation and you move on, problem solved. But in reality, do you not see some other weaknesses in that overall program? Do you see the latent side of that event? This is the active trigger. If you look at that active trigger versus latent weaknesses, this is the latent weakness side. And both have impact on the final event. And so if you take that new HP type process and you work your mind around that type of mentality, what you see is you can highlight some yellow in there that makes sense. There was no gloves. There was no pre-job brief, minimal instructions. You can go down the list and see where I was trying to save time, error precursors. You can see where I overloaded the grading and nobody was monitoring or correcting me. So there's some supervisory influence there. There was minimal instructions. And then as you move down, the walking surface was uneven. I didn't evaluate anything. I didn't wear gloves because it just wasn't a requirement. So it tells you more, doesn't it? That's a big one as well. Yep, I agree.
Where was your head? If it's a three-man crew, why are you doing all the work?
I was the low man on. I was the grunt. That's the way it worked. Yeah, but a great question. They're just looking over there. I'll be honest, they just looked at you and laughed at you most of the time. And that's kind of the way that works. Yeah, but great question. So, but do you see active error versus latent weaknesses, how they work? And we tend to rest and stay in this green. But that's kind of the old way of thinking. If we want to get better, we have to think about weaknesses downstream. And so that's where you can begin to put long-term corrective actions in place. And so if you look at just maybe pre-planning and procedural issues, you can pick, you know, two or three things out there that would have made a big difference. Now, are those things that I intentionally did to break a rule? Which is a great question. We look at things a lot of times as though that person was trying to break the rule. All right? We all are guilty of that. But in reality, is there a difference between a rule violation and just a mistake or a lapse of judgment? You better believe it. Especially if you're in that knowledge zone of that skill-based type parameters. The idea is that I didn't intentionally violate anything. I just didn't use good judgment because honestly, I didn't know what I didn't know. And so the reality was an organization has some responsibility in the process too. So being able to take that and put things in place that influence the future is the key. Whether it's pre-planning tools with job briefs, whether it's walking down jobs before you do them, whether it's PPE assessments and things of that nature, orientations and safety training, they set the tone and the overall culture. That is an HP type mentality. And the reality is it extends well beyond the act of error, the David Lynn mess up. And so that is essentially what HP is all about. It takes a timeline, and you can think chronologically in that timeline, but it really works 360 degrees around that timeline in a dynamic way. And so when you put context around events and the way things occur, you can analyze the facts, collect those facts, but collect the full body of facts and not just the blaming facts. You're collecting the context of the event. And with that, you can analyze the event in a different light. But you have to be honest with yourself as a safety person, an organization in a leadership type role. You've got to look at it and say, okay, that person made a mistake, but how can I help the other 10 people not make the same mistake? And so that's the key for me, is that of course people are going to make mistakes and things are going to happen, but how do I influence the 10 and not just the one? Does that make sense? And so when you do that, that's where you influence the future. If you stop with the act of error, you only influence a person. And so if you extend beyond that into the latent weaknesses, you influence the future of that organization. And so that, to me, is the essence of HP.